comments for me on the last vlog and choose one question, please.
I think this is a good question, inshallah. Tariq, he says, question, how do you differentiate between what Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did in his daily life and that which is the sunnah? Covering the head and eating certain food.
Very simple answer.
The ulama of Islam, they have discussed the actions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in different categories. Things that the Prophet alayhi wasallam did in public versus private. Things that the Prophet alayhi wasallam did himself and told the people to do as well. Things that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did and he explained to them his barakah, his reward, his virtue. Jibril has come to me with it. Allah has commanded me to. Things that the Messenger of Allah did as a human being, something that was an Arab custom, something of his time, of his places, of his location, and it is not included or attributed or attached to any type of worship or revelation or barakah. So therefore, that which the Prophet said and he told the companions to do, it's not like something he did in his home. Something that he did in his home and Aisha or Maymuna relates pertaining to ibadah, ghusl. How he dressed like this when he wanted to pray. That's not the same as something that he did as a normal human being with his wife. Alright? How the Prophet dressed, if he tells us the virtue of wearing a color, the virtue of covering his head, the virtue of wearing this type of sock, the virtue of this, then that's one thing. And if not, it's an Arab custom. And it is not an absolute sunnah. It is not an absolute sunnah. Wearing white is sunnah, no doubt about that. The Prophet ﷺ has given us a specific piece of instruction, text. Inna khayra or inna min khayri thiyabikum lahadha al-bayad. The best clothes that you can wear is white. Those who are living should wear them, and those who are dead should be shrouded therein. Nas wadih. All right, authentic hadith, okay? As far as the Prophet said, I'm wearing a turban, for example, or wearing kuhl in his eyes, or other things, but let's say wearing a turban. Is there an authentic hadith in which the Prophet said, I'm talks about the virtue of a turban after the imamah? Believers should wear the imamah, Jibril came to me wearing an imamah, etc. If we have that, then we say it's sunnah to wear an imamah. And if we don't have that authentic text, even though the Prophet wore an imamah, and the Sahaba wore an imam, they wore imamahs, turbans, then we say it's adah, it's custom. It's a custom of the Arabs. And if a person does it with the intention of totally taking the example of the Prophet in everything, then inshallah ta'ala he'll get the reward for that. But it is not attributed or categorized as sunnah mutlaqa, as sunnah ada, sunnat ada. What am I saying? It's a sunnah of custom. And the only time once you get the reward, if you only do it just because of the Prophet. The Prophet loved to drink honey. The Prophet loved to wear this type of fabric or this type of leather. But it doesn't mean that that's the sunnah to wear that specific leather or skin or hide, etc. That's custom of the Arabs. And the same applies to the prophetic medicine. And ulama, they explain this. Al-tibba nabawi, quote unquote, is on two types, two categories. That which tib is the Prophet attributes to Allah. He attributes to barakah. He attributes to shifa. He attributes to Jannah. It came down from paradise. It came so. And that which is tib that the Arabs practice, that they got from the Abyssinians, or they got from the Greeks, or they got from the ancient Egyptians, etc. And you can use it if you want to, eat this type of leaf or bark, or use this type of cauterization or whatever, or you can go to the modern hospital and take pills or any other type of traditional holistic medicine. So it has to be tafsir. And one of the most important, valuable lessons that we've learned from the ulama in Medina is tafsir, detail. Detail. It has to be a detail. Everything is not black and white. It's not so simple. And it's this or it's that. It doesn't work like that. And this legacy of everything being absolute and black and white has been a legacy spread by those people who don't have a lot of knowledge. And it's convenient to say yay or nay. It's convenient to say a one-way street. It's convenient to say if it's this, then it's that. And if you look carefully, you find the further a person is from knowledge and intelligence, the more he wants to just make it absolute for his argument, though. All right? For his argument. And he'll say it's tafsil when someone is attacking him. But when he's on the offense, mutlaq, black and white. There's no such thing as gray. There's no detail. That's wrong.
Well,
Barak Allah for you, Sheikh. Nuruddin.
Let's take another one, man.
Another question?
Yeah. Sister Act. Okay, she says, question. What is the ruling on sisters wearing false eyelashes to all sisters, even at weddings? I heard Mufti say in a Q&A that this was permissible. However, I would like to confirm and also know why this ruling is different from that of wearing hair extensions. Yeah, a lot of what you want. So yeah, is that clear?
What's the last part about the hair extensions?
You said, and she wants to, like, she heard you saying that.
I got the eyelashes, but what about the extensions? The hair extensions.
Why is it different?
Why is this different from hair extensions?
Clear. Wada, fine. Jazakallah khair. On the channel, we did a few lessons on hair extensions, a few detailed discussions from a book of a modern day scholar and a modern day researcher, a woman, a doctor. The name of the book or the discussion of the book is Ahkam At-Tajmeel or Al-Ahkam At-Tajmeeliyya fi Sunnat Al-Mutahara. Rulings of beautification. Cosmetic rulings. Mm. Cosmetic fiqh. The fiqh of cosmetics. In this book, this doctor, she discusses hair, eyelashes, tattoos, wigs, etc. She brings up the issue of the rumush al-istina'iyya, fake eyelashes or cosmetic eyelashes or enhanced eyelashes, a better way of saying it. And she discusses that the scholars of Islam, they don't unite upon a ruling. It's not a unanimous consensus of it being haram or being lawful. Some of them say that it's permissible because it isn't included in the wasl of the head. La'anallahu al-wasila wal-mustawsila. Even the ulama of Islam, as we discussed in the video, they have a long discussion of wasl. Can a woman wear a weave or wig or yarn? That's a very long, detailed discussion, which is on the channel. Please go back to it. In which we have translated it. And we have given a lot of efforts in explaining how the book is put together. And she mentions the madahib, the Shafi'iyah, the Malikiyah. What do they say about a woman extending her hair? Can or can she not? Absolutely, or etc. So therefore, the eyelashes is going to be, according to those scholars, a branch of the discussion of the hair. So those who say that a woman cannot make any extension of her hair, some of them say that the sha'r of the eyes is included in wasal. It's included in wasal. It's included in the extension, and therefore it being haram. And others, they may say it's haram because it damages the eyes. It does harms to the eyes. Some say that. Is that authentic or is that true? I don't know. And some say that it's going to be unlawful because it's deception. And that's the illah of the hair being false and the hair being fake. Alright? And then there are others who say no, it isn't included in the wasl of the head. It's different. It's a different part of the body. It doesn't have the same meaning and it doesn't have the same effect. As long as the sister wears it behind closed doors in front of her husband, her mahrams, in front of her sisters, no one is uploading her pictures or to someone or whatever the case may be, and it doesn't hurt or harm her eyes. So it's two main views. If you have doubt, then the rule is to do without. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Da' ma yaribuka ila ma la yaribuka." Leave off that which causes you doubt, and do that which doesn't cause you doubt. فَإِنَّ الصِّدْقَ تُمَأْنِينَ وَالْكَذِبَ رِيبَ. People don't mention the end of that hadith. There's another addition. فَإِنَّ الصِّدْقَ تُمَأْنِينَ. And that's because truthfulness is rest, peace of mind. وَالْكَذِبَ رِيبَ. And lying is no peace of mind. So therefore, you have any doubt, then do a doubt. But just because you have a doubt on an issue, it doesn't mean that it automatically becomes haram and that you can't take the other view that makes sense to you and you believe that's correct. And many people, they make a mistake with regards to this. Oh, it's doubtful, so I'm going to stay away from it. Not all of the time. Sometimes you follow that which the proof states. Sometimes you follow that which makes the most sense, even though it isn't the safest view. And the ulama of Islam, they bring up this issue. What should be followed? Al-ahwatu aw al-arshad. That which is safest or that which is strongest. Because there could be a view, let's say for example, a woman covering her hands and face. Is it obligatory? Is it recommended? Etc. Alright? A person may say, the safest view is for a woman to cover her hands and her face. That's ahwat. No doubt about that. But it doesn't mean that I, in my heart, believe that the proofs and evidence is stating that she must cover her hands and face are stronger. And the sister says, this makes the most sense to me. This is clear to me that I do not have to cover my hands and my face. You can't say, you can't follow the dalil, and you just have to stick to what? The precautionary view. And a lot of many people, they make that mistake. All right? So at the end of the day, I just want to have to go back to your own discretion. Me personally, if a sister wore fake eyelashes, I wouldn't prefer it. And I wouldn't recommend it. I wouldn't advise you there. What about water?
But I cannot forget you.
Funniest moment? Oh man, that's hard to say.
I think I can remember.
Probably the late night in the hood one.
Which one?
Late night
was
in the
Notre Dame. Look for the Airbnb.
Yeah, that may have been one. Or what else was it?
No, I don't
the
think
blocks.
So. I think it was. Stein. I think it was the chicken bowl.
When you took the food from the table, you said what you said. Allah Mustafa. Allah Mustafa.
I have a Saeed.
How'd it go?
Ready to go back home?
No doubt about that. Waiting to meet my adoring fans at home.
Mashallah.
Nice green, mashallah. May Allah bless you.
What about you, Shay?
Blue, azraq.
With the socks and everything on, huh?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Those are actually like wasps or bees.
Mm-hmm.
They're not flowers.
Mashallah. Why, are you saying that flowers are not nice?
No, I love flowers. But people, they confuse your flowers with the...
What's going on, guys? Look who I am with.
Hey.
MashaAllah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alaf Muhammad, subhanAllah, he forced me to come to Liverpool on Sunday morning to see our other sensei, Abu Usama al-Zahabi. May Allah preserve him. So we had to answer the request, you know. He doesn't know Liverpool. I don't want him to get lost.
SubhanAllah, I might get jumped or something here.
You know, so alhamdulillah, we accompanied the brothers and helped them out.
Yeah, you came here before?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Good time.
So, hey guys, you know, I told Notre Dame, you gotta come and people asking in the vlogs and whatnot. We need to actually make a...
Why is that? We need to make like a video where...
A serious video,
where,
right?
Like, a serious one where yeah. We see, because I was reading the one comment, I think it was 2 days ago. The guy was like, don't do this. This is, I was like, come on, this is inside and outside jokes.
Yeah.
I know what they're saying. I see what the brother might not like it. I'm like, yeah, but, you know.
Okay, we go into the office.
يا طالب العلم قم لا تنم فإن الزمان انقضى وانصرم فكن ما حييت ظنينا به فظنك بالوقت عين الكرم وكن حلس درسك وافرح به تكن قائدا في غد للأمم وبادر شبابك من قبل أن يقطع عزمك سيف الهرم ودع ما استطعت فضول اختلاط وأكل ونوم وقول يذم وصاحب نبيلا ولا تكثرن فكم مكثر يا أخي حرم وحقق إذا رمت شيئا ولا تسمن بوهمك ذات الورم رأيت العلوم وأصحابها لدى كل ذي فطرة تحترم فإن رمت يا صاحبي رفعة بدنيا وأخرى فلذ بالقلم وأخلص لربك واعمل بما علمت وإن تلقى فيه الألم وصابر وثابر ولا تكسلا فإن الهموم بقدر الهمم
بقدر الهمم.